Let's go on for a little while. Now, usually as I go into the second session hour, we kind of get a little more relaxed in terms of, if you want to ask questions or make observations, we just hold your hand and we'll do so. At the same time, I want to continue with this chapter. All right. So this is part two. You do not understand that to oppose the Holy Spirit is to frighten yourself. He tells you but your will. He speaks for you. And his divinity is but your own. So I sort of said something about this a moment ago, but let me really emphasize it. It seems sort of strange. One of the problems that we have is that we tend to project the Holy Spirit as well as being something which is outside of us. And we use words like he. As though we are talking about something else, like that there was a person that was out there that is giving us directions. And the truth of the matter is that if there is no separation, there is no Holy Spirit as a being, which is something separate from you. We need a way of talking about your right mind, which is already a part of your mind. It's already there. So it's really just a matter of letting go of the faults so that we become more accustomed of what's true. So we're starting to think in alignment with the right mind, just as Ramanujan did it with mathematics and got to see the truth. You know, we can do it in our own personal lives so that we see the truth being manifest. And it's really manifest as we begin, again, just to review, can we dropping the projections, dropping the attack thoughts, entering into forgiveness, and just loving whatever. Loving whatever. I was. It's Ellen, right? We were talking for briefly during the break. And keep in mind, there's two kinds of projection. One kind of projection that we're very most familiar with is the projection which is an attack, which is condemnation, which is judgment, which is a mistaken perception. There's another kind of projection which the Course refers to as extension, which is the right kind of projection. And that projection is that we are projecting love. We are projecting love all the time under all different sort of circumstances, so it doesn't make any difference who you're encountering or what sort of circumstances you are. You're in a tense situation at work with a colleague or with a family member or just a stranger. You know, it's still your job not to fall into the fear. Hold on to what's, and don't forget that it doesn't make any difference who this is. Even the most hardened of criminal, right, is not, God is not absent there. Not at all. In fact, as it may be very buried very deeply, but there is a sweet soul buried under there that's crying, I mean crying, for release and recognition as, so the way the Course in Miracles says that we heal other people, and you can heal other people. The way that you do it is by seeing them as being whole and perfect and innocent. You see the innocence within them. You do not see the faults. You do not see the problems. They may be there, and they may be rapid. They may be all over the surface. But you're looking past that to see. That's what Jesus did. That's why people love Jesus, you know, because he saw the innocence in everyone. Last time we were talking about how there's a passage from the Bible where the Sadducees and Pharisees were accusing him of eating with publicans and prostitutes and sinners. And he says, no, these are just folks, you know, just like you and me. You know, we don't discriminate about anyone. God is present in everyone. But so it's easy to see it in a baby. You know, it's easy to see it under certain circumstances. The challenge is to be able to see it regardless of circumstances. Right? All right, so let's go along with this. So this divinity, it's your own divinity. What you're really doing in the ultimate sense is you're really recognizing that your mind is a part of the mind of God, and you're accepting the fact that your mind is a part of the mind of God. And all he knows is but your knowledge, save for you that you may do your will through him. So it's your will. See, that's the problem is that we think that God's will and our will are two different things. That they're not two different things. When you do God's will, you are doing your will. You are doing what you want to do the most. The ego doesn't buy that because the ego thinks, if I do what God wants, I'm dead. That's true. And God wins. It's true. God does win. There's no doubt God's going to win. So he might as well let God win now. You know, so you can be happy now because it's the only way to be really, truly contented. And all he knows is but your knowledge, save for you that you may do your will through him. God asks you, do your will. He joins with you. He did not set his kingdom up alone. When he says he did not sing that, we're all in this together. It's the only way it can be. And not only are we all in this together, the truth is, and I keep emphasizing, there's only one mind. There's really only one of us here trying to think that we're separate. Go on. And heaven itself but represents your will, where everything created is for you. No spark of life but was created with your glad consent, as you would have it be. And not one thought that God has ever had but waited for your blessing to be born. God is no enemy to you. He has no more than that he hear you call him friend. And that means everyone, too, is our friend, right? God but ensured that you would never lose your will when he gave you his perfect answer. The perfect answer, by the way, is the Holy Spirit, okay? That's the answer that God gave you. So he puts in the mind that the Course says the very instant the separation occurred, the very second the separation, there was not even it says not a note in heaven's song was missed. There wasn't even a bleep on the, you know, the instant this thought of separation occurred, the cure was also there. It was built in to the problem, the cure, all came exactly, which is one of the reasons that nothing ever happened. Well, it sure looks like it did, right? Okay, so hear it now. I mean, we can hear this at any time. That you may remember of his love and learn your will. This is your will. Your will and God's will are the same will. God would not have his son made prisoner to what he does not want. He joins with you in willing you be free. This is real freedom. See, the paradox is that the ego thinks that doing God's will is losing freedom. The truth is that doing God's will is gaining freedom. It's like if you think about some sort of art that you're developing. We've got some musicians in the room and others. And, you know, it's like as you create it, as you get better at it, as you become perfected in it, in living in this particular case, then it just becomes automatically that you're doing God's will. And it feels good. It just feels right because you're not projecting, you're not angry, you're not attacking. Well, you got to know that. He joins with you in willing you be free, and to oppose him is to make a choice against yourself. Why would we go against ourselves? And yet we do. We go against it. We make these decisions that go against ourselves. Right? Well, I'll have another drink. Whatever. Right? And it's a decision that's going against me. And choose that you be bound. So let's go on. Your will is boundless. That's an interesting idea. Boundless. Right? It is not your will that it be bound. What lies in you has joined with God himself in all creation's birth. Remember him who has created you and through you will create everything. And that's, I think that's one of the things that Course talks a lot about is creation and creating. And it asks that we be creative through the process of extension. Now, don't think of that just in terms of some sort of art. Think of that as the extension of love. So really, God asks that we extend, that we be extending our love at all times and in all places. We talked a little bit, I don't know how to spend a lot more time on idols, but just a little bit. Idols are limits. It's a very important point. Idols are limits. So think about, if I could use the illustration of the guy who bought the $65,000 BMW was going to cost him $800 a month for the next 6 years of his life, right? He just put himself in prison, right? The prison is that he now has to bow at the foot of this idol to the tune of $800 a month, something he thought he wanted, something he thought would be impressive. And his wife is screaming, no, this is, I mean, she's not, in a way she's screaming, this is an idol. This isn't reality. You're buying an idol. It's a very practical kind of illustration, but it could be other things as well, right? They are beliefs that are forms that will bring, they are the beliefs that there are forms that will bring happiness and that by limiting it is attained. It's not attained. The truth is, divine abstraction takes joy in sharing. And let's go on. It is as if you said, I have no need of everything. God is everything. Truth is everything. Love is everything. The little thing I want, and it will be as everything to me. This little thing I want. And this little thing is nothing. The BMW is nothing. You know, whatever it is. I mean, that's just a good example, right? Right? It's really nothing at all. It's a limit. It's not freedom. And this must fail to satisfy. It won't satisfy. So what? So what? You're driving a fancy sports car. Because it is your will that everything be yours. Decide for idols and you ask for loss. Right? Decide for truth and everything is yours. That's like saying, aside for love and everything is yours. And the whole world is yours. And everything that's, which means that all of life is yours. It is not form you seek. And this is very important. In the Course draws this very important distinction between form and abstract. We just had the quote on here, it said divine abstraction, which is another word for God. Divine abstraction takes joy in sharing. What's real does not have a form. That's why there's no earth. That's not why there's no world. That's why you're not a body. Because everything that's a body, including the world, it all disappears. In case you hadn't noticed, every body disappears. Right? So there's no reality in any body. There's no reality in any form. Love does not have a form. God does not have a form. Our minds are trained to think in terms of form. But even in watching the show with Ramanujan and the mathematics, you know, it really doesn't have a form. It was interesting. In the show, the man who knew infinity, Ramanujan was a deeply religious Hindu, right? and very committed to his relationship with God, right? So it was easier for him to say that God gave him this, God gave him this information. But it wasn't anything other than knowledge, right? And knowledge is not a thing either. If you see what I'm saying, it's not a, we maybe have a practical use for it. The Course actually equates knowledge and heaven. Knowledge is of heaven. Heaven is knowledge. It's knowing. What it's knowing is knowing God. It's what it's knowing, right? And it's knowing it without doubt. So it's knowing it without question. What form can take the place of the all, the love, and the divinity of Son, of God the Son? What idol can be made two of what is one? And can the limits be limited? You do not want an idol. All idols take us away from the truth rather than to the truth. So maybe my idol is fame. There's a show called American Idol, right? Which is about people getting to become famous because of their singing or whatever it is. Right? So we make idols. Right? Yes. Oh, I'm sorry, Joan. It's important that you have a microphone.
Speak like you're licking a lollipop. Don't.
What I wanted to say is that we all have idols here in the dream. We have families, their idols, and friends, their idols, and grandchildren. And yet, you know, we're being told we don't want them. Well, maybe that's true, but how do you live without an idol, a loved one or something? You know, there's a contradiction between will of the dream and the will of God.
What all its course is asking us is that we not make something else more important than God. Okay, but how do we find God? One, we find God in relationship. We find God through our brothers and through our sisters and through the connection that is there because God is there. Okay. That's where God is. So you're not losing anything. You're not making them into an idol in that sense.
Okay.
You're really finding God there.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, sure, through that love process. Maurice? All right, you got to have the mic.
Sorry.
It's okay.
My last interaction with you was about the presumption that there is a God. And
yes.
We finished concluding that love was... So what I'd like to ask is not Christianity and Hinduism basically the teaching of greater love?
Yes.
What does it matter whether you have a position like the Course of the unreality of this, you know, mm-hmm. non-dualism or whatever,
right.
whatever. But what I'm trying to say is, why do we need to limit ourselves to a particular intellectual position if just greater love is preached by all,
right,
and the goal of all?
Well, let me answer that first, but I think you're going to go to another question.
The other one is related, and then I'll finish.
All right, so...
The Course specifically says, I know, and this bothers me, a miracle happens between one who has more to one who has less.
Temporarily, the word is temporarily is in there.
Okay, I guess they answered that question.
I guess they did.
The more important one is the
okay. So the Course also says, at some point you take this book and you throw it away. Okay, because it is not necessary. Okay. it's a thing, just like, but it's a tool, it's a lesson, it's a workbook, just like all of our textbook. This is a textbook which is giving us the right kind of direction. In that sense, it's a path. It doesn't make any difference what path you follow. It doesn't matter if it's Buddhism, or I'm going to do meditation, I'm going to be a Hindu. The path is completely irrelevant. All paths disappear. All paths fade into God. So it doesn't make it. But the important point is that I choose a path, and I choose something that works, and I stick with it. And then I thought it was interesting what Yasko said in the beginning about meditation and about meditation centers that are opening up, because I was reading some statistical stuff on this. You may know about how rapidly traditional Christianity is dying, both here in the United States in particular, and also it's even faster in Europe, okay? Churches are practically empty in some places in Europe. And if you look on the chart, it's just going like that. The Methodist Church, for example, in the United States has lost 50% of its membership in the past 50 years, just as a simple illustration. Half in 50 years. That's very, very rapid descent, right? Presbyterians, faster than that, right? But there's an interesting thing that's going on. The growth of yoga centers, the growth of meditation centers are going like this. Now, how come, you know, meditation centers and yoga centers and these other kind of places they're shooting up the charts on the other end? We're tired of the traditional do-it-this-way rules, regulations, we got to follow this. And then there's all kinds of structures and strictures and restrictions which get in the way. So we're looking for free. So it's exciting that this is happening in this way. So all we're doing is just find whatever works. You don't have to do anything. Yeah, you take somebody like Thoreau, okay? Thoreau never went to church. And yet we would regard Thoreau as one of our deepest spiritual beings who walked around on this planet and found God in nature and found God in his own mind, which is the place where Ramanujan found him, where we all ultimately find him, right? Shanti, you want to? No, you got to have a mic. You cannot work without a mic. I'm really sorry, but.
I don't know whether you asked that question.
Please wait till you get the mic.
I don't know whether you asked that question. What do you call a question when you don't expect an answer? That's the word I want. Thank you very much. It's on the tip of my tongue. But the yoga thing, it's very interesting because its focus is completely on the body. So we've given up the religion. Religions, I hear them, and we see the body and physical. The physical is being emphasized. Take a look, health clubs. You don't have to be into yoga.
But one of the things that this particular article I was talking about saying that one of the basic differences. You're right. We're using the body. The course is the body is a tool. It's an instrument. We use it. Meditation is also very often very much a part of yoga. So what happens when people come home from a yoga session is that they're peaceful, they're relaxed, they're in the right kind of, it helps the frame of mind. Whereas people who go to church and get into political hassles with the other members of the congregation wind up going home distressed and upset. You know, one is relieving stress and one's creating stress. Which way do you want to go?
Well, that's interesting because as we said in the car coming down, there's been a study that's been made about runners, and you people who are runners
sure.
may notice that you get kind of high.
Of course.
And they've likened the high that you get to running as being very similar to the high that you get on marijuana, which will soon become legalized here, I understand. For those of you who are chafing at the bit.
Thank you, Shanti. Okay. Yeah, get the mic.
I've always found this to be incredibly helpful, especially when it comes to judgments of other people's paths and, you know, comparing paths as well. Clarification for terms. For Christ, the oneness of God takes on many forms and teaches to all who can learn without fear until their oneness can be recognized. So if Jesus is somebody that I can relate to that is calming to me and can teach me without fear, or if the Course in Miracles is something that I can relate to that I'm not fearful of, then that's my path. And, you know, but you'll get to a place on your journey where you start to see, oh, Shiva is a teacher too. Ganesh is a teacher too. Gandhi is a Buddha. You know, you start to become unafraid of all these, and then you step back and you're like, wow, they're all one. You know, they're all one in the end. But we pick one that we're not afraid of to lead us to that place until we recognize they're all one.
Very good, Brad. Mm. That's why that we're part of a seminary here, which actually meets in this room on the day before this class, called All Faith Seminary, because we're recognizing the truth in all the faith traditions. And that this is really the wave of the future. It's really the move of I started working with the creation of the interfaith stuff with Rabbi Guberman back in 1972, 73. And it's just been phenomenal that it finally, it used to be when you would go into a hospital, for example, you check in, you had to ask your faith. And you get Protestant, Catholic, you know, Jewish, whatever. And many years ago, I said interfaith, and they said, that's not a category. You know, it's now a category. Yeah? So things change. Billy, you got to have the mic, Bill.
I guess the big thing about yoga everybody leaves out is it doesn't matter what race, color, size, or age, right? There's no separation at all. Whoever walks in, from a little girl, I've taught 13-year-old girls, 80-year-old people.
That's right.
Every color, every race, and everybody's together.
It all
works. It's like when I was in Homestead, Pennsylvania, I was looking for a cemetery, you know, and my cousin died, you know.
I see.
So the guy says to me, oh, you don't want to go there. That's a Catholic cemetery. And I'm Catholic. You know, that's that separation there.
Yeah, that's separation.
Yeah.
Very good. All right, I want to skip ahead here, if you will excuse me, because I know what's in here. And I want to get to this point because in about 10 or 15 minutes, we're going to take another break, and then Francis is going to come up. But I really wanted to get to this point here. So I love it when the Course in Miracles is so incredibly affirmative. By affirmative, I mean it's very clear. And one of the words that actually appears a lot in the Course in Miracles is the word nothing. And ultimately, and never, you know, those kind of words are complete. And they're clear, all right, so never. Okay, so let's go here. Anger is never justified. This is from this text. So the word here is never. It doesn't say sometimes. If it said sometimes, we could have debates about which times it was and which times it isn't. You know, and there'd be a lot of opinion about that. It's never justified. Which again doesn't mean you should never get angry. It just means that if you do, you have to recognize that something has gone wrong with your thinking processes. I had this strange thing happen. I won't say where this happened or when it happened or anything, but it happened not long ago. I was giving a talk in another city, and I was talking about in defenselessness, my safety lies, right? And this was in an afternoon workshop. It wasn't very service. And then I said, anger is never justified. And when I said, anger is never justified, all of a sudden, a man on the second row shot up out of his chair like that and looked at me and walked out of the room just like that, right? And I hit a nerve there, I think. And interestingly, his wife still continued to sit there. And we were about 10 or 15 minutes away from a break like we are now, and he didn't leave. I went out, and he was sitting in the vestibule of the church. And I went over to him and I said, did I say something to upset you? And he said, yes. And I said, which part? And he said, all of it. And so I said, okay, we won't try to work on this. He said, right. So obviously, you know, it's if anger, this is someone who felt that anger was justified, right? And that to say in defenselessness, my safety lies is garbage as far as I. So we really have to watch out for that kind of that thinking. And we especially have to watch, of course, as always, we want to watch for it in ourselves. And we know that there's a lot of this kind of stuff going on in our country. And I won't go into elaborating that because I don't have time. Yes.
The reason why anger is never justified is because anger does not have a cause.
Very good.
And without a cause, there is no true effect. And so you just can't say anger is never justified, because we can justify anger in so many ways if we try to, but the underlining yes. anger, there is no cause, and without anything without a cause does not exist. So that's why it's never justified.
Thanks, Brad. That's the same point or idea that I was making earlier about kind of looking at to see if you're upset or whatever it is, this, to look to see what is the cause. That's the real question, is where is that coming from? Why would I get upset or be angry? What's the root? You got to go to the root to get to be able to heal it. And if you don't go to the root, you won't heal, right? You got to expose the root, so to speak. That's where, and once you expose the root, then you have an opportunity for it to let it go and to really be a healing. Hi, Marvin. I got to have the mic.
I have a great example of that once happened to
okay.
me. I was in some seminar, and all of a sudden it occurred to me, like all my life I was angry at my father. And I went to take a bathroom break, and I'm standing there. I'm just asking myself, why am I angry at my father? What has he done that caused this anger? And, you know, I couldn't answer the question. Like, nothing would come up that would say, yes, this is the reason. There was no reason. That practically changed my whole life around.
I mean, great. All right. Probably an authority problem. All right. Let's go on with this. So, anger is never justified. Pardon is always justified. So we got never and always, right? So there's always justified. It's always a right choice, right? Anger is never justified. Attack has no foundation. If you're reading this particular section of this chapter, it's right in the beginning of chapter 30, section 6, these quotes. This is the first sentence of the first paragraph, and then this is the first sentence in the next paragraph. See, this is 1, 2, so it's right. So we're going into this. So attack has no foundation. That's what you're really saying. There's really no foundation. You think there's a foundation, or the ego thinks that there's a foundation, right? And if you want to dig back far enough, you'd probably find an authority problem or something there that you could, but it has no foundation. That has no foundation, right? Pardon is always justified. It has a sure foundation. Again, I've told the story, but for those who don't know, and I'm not going to tell the whole story, but just if you ask Bill Thetford what he was doing during the last years of his life. Now, Bill Thetford was Helen's cohort in production of the course, right? If you ask him what he was doing, he would say that he was practicing forgiveness. What we're all doing is practicing forgiveness. And the big forgiveness that we're practicing isn't with regard to anybody except ourselves for having made the wrong choices in the first place, you know. Actually, if you really forgive yourself, you realize you actually did the best you could at the time, even if it was a wrong choice. In other words, you have to forgive yourself for not having known better, because you actually did not know better at the time. You somehow thought that was the right thing to do. This is one really exciting thing about the Course in Miracles is that it helps you understand that even when you make the wrong choice, it is the right choice. Because it all always works out if you'll let it work out. The answer is there, even when the false stuff is mixed in with it. The perfect illustration, which I've used before, is it's like a GPS system. It's always giving, the Holy Spirit is like GPS, it's always giving you the right direction. Always giving, you may not make the choice to follow that direction, but the direction is always the right direction. And GPS does not scold you when you make the wrong choice. Used to be they would say, recalculating, now they've dropped the recalculating. It just, here's the right answer. Just keep giving you the right answer. Just keep giving you the right answer. You don't have to follow it. Nothing says you got to do this, that you have free will. You can do whatever you want to do, but you can also get yourself into trouble with doing whatever you think you want to do because you have the free will. So pardon is always justified. It's a sure found. It's always the right choice. Right? That doesn't mean, by the way, that people who act out in society in inappropriate ways and do things that are hurtful to other people don't have to go to jail. I mean, we don't allow folks who don't seem to understand that you don't hurt other people have free rein on being able to hurt other people, for example, right? So it'd be nice if we could know how to solve that problem. But we haven't even solved it inside our own minds yet, let alone think that we could solve it anybody else. Let me just see if there's anything beyond this. So the new interpretation, would God have left the meaning of the world to your interpretation? See, that's where it gets crazy, is we think that we have the right interpretation. Look at what's going on in politics. I'm not going to talk about politics. Just look at what's going on in politics. Who's got the right interpretation? Everybody's got the right interpretation, right? And it's all wrong. If he had said it has no meaning, for it cannot be that meaning changes constantly and yet is true. Heaven is a state of constancy. I think this is a very difficult concept for us to understand, but there's no change. It's constant. Truth is true, and it's always true. Love is true, and love is always true. There's not a kind of course, there's not a kind of love for this and a kind of love for that. It's one thing, which is unchanging, and it doesn't have different form. There's only one form. It doesn't make any difference. It's not like you have love for a baby is different than the love for your brother or your wife. It's one thing. Escape from simply judgment simply lies in this. All things have but one purpose which you share with all the world, and that is this extension of love, right? Appearance is deceived but can be changed. Reality is changeless. That's one of the major points I'm making in the book on there called Perfect Love. And I think we're about done with this. Let's just do this and then we'll take our next break. Your brother has a changeless in him beyond appearance and deception. I've talked about this idea before, right? Both. It is obscured by changing views of him that you perceive as his reality. The happy dream about him takes the form of the appearance of his perfect health, his perfect freedom from all forms of lack and safety from disaster of your kind. Remember I said earlier that you can heal another, but the only way that you can heal another is by seeing them as being perfectly whole and innocent and complete. And they, if you do that, they will, maybe not consciously, but will begin to get it. It will begin to seep in, right? And that makes for very loving relationships. It makes for very healthy relationships as well. Okay. Let's take another short, this time let's just do 10 minutes and then we're going to have, Francis is going to come talk to us, okay? Just 10 minutes this time instead of 15. It's, when I write a book like Living A Course in Miracles, this is taking it all the way. and doing, which it has to be done. We have to take it, but how that manifests in your life would be very different from for each of us, of course. But it just shows you it works, and that's what's the exciting thing about it. And trust is the first characteristic. I love that story about JP, that it was sort of John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist Church, that one young minister came to him once and was complaining about the fact that he didn't have faith. And he said, well, just preach faith until you've got it, you know. So it's a similar kind of an idea. Does anybody want to share your cards? We do this for a few minutes. But you got to have a mic. There's a mic on this side of the room and a mic on this side of the room. There should be. I've got one mic. So let's start here.
You cannot enter into real relationships with any of God's sons unless you love them all and equally. Love is not special.
All real pleasures come from doing God's will.
True.
Do you prefer to be happy or right?
Child of God, you were created to create the good, the beautiful, and the holy. Do not forget this.
Illness is some form of external searching. Health is inner peace.
To accept your littleness is arrogant because it means that you believe your evaluation of yourself is truer than God's.
Not everybody has to, if you want to just pass on. We only have 5 minutes.
Well, I like this one.
Okay, good.
God himself is incomplete without me.
Very good. Yeah.
Okay.
Give me your glasses. Go ahead. No? Pass it on then.
All right, here we go. Somebody insisted. All right. True denial is a powerful, you get your hand out, so I don't know what you want. A protective device. You can and should deny any belief that error can hurt you.
Right. Can I just say something about that one? There was a slide I didn't get to on here today. The course, in a way, is not about affirming the affirmative. It's about denying the negative. Does that make sense? It's not, you can affirm the affirmative. There's nothing really wrong, but it's not about that. It's about negating the negative. It's about saying that this is not true, you know. That's how we come to the truth. And recognizing it, as Francis says, miracles, everyone's right, but purification is necessary first.
I place the peace of God in your heart and in your hands to hold and share. The heart is pure to hold it, and the hands are strong to give it. We cannot lose.
Anybody else on this side? Let's go to this side then. Who's got the mic? Who'd like Stavrov? Are you going to get the mic this way? It's me. Oh! Okay. Nora? Yes.
Double-barreled.
Okay.
When you want only love, you will see nothing else.
Isn't it nice how simple the course is? And, you know, and this, a few more.
Have faith in only this one thing, and it will be sufficient. God wills you be in heaven, and nothing can keep you from it or it from you.
All right. Anybody else on the side? Okay, let's wrap up then. Let me just say in a couple things. I guess our next time is June. I think it's the 12th of. Is that right? Who's got a copy of it? Let me see the. Or does it say on there? Whatever the second Sunday in June is, I think it's the 12th. And that will be the last time we will have completed all 31 chapters. There are a few people like Shanti here and Lily Katz here and a few others who have been every single time. They've been at every class. And then, as I said, Rod is coming in July. And then in September, we start a new kind of program that's going to be going on. Thanks some of those of you who are new. How many came from Mary Ann? I'm just curious. From, okay, so let's know. They're all in the back row. you probably read Mary Ann and I have a sort of an interesting background that we've known each other for 43 years. And we shared the same brownstone in the Upper West Side here in New York City before the course ever came into existence, which was, well, it was existed, but nobody knew about it. All right, sort of a, and she now lives, that's sort of interesting, in the same building I lived in back in the 70s here in New York City. And we went to the same college town, Claremont, California. And I did my master's there, and she later did her, we were working on her undergraduate. So it's strange overlaps, but she's been very supportive, and it's very nice. So, we end by sharing the Lord's Prayer from the Course in Miracles, which is on the last page of the course, of the booklet. And for those of you who would like, we go out and have a bite to eat, if you have time. It's at the Saigon Cafe. It's a Vietnamese cafe. It's a lovely place. It's got excellent food. We always enjoy going there. It's literally two blocks down 12th Street, rather, and then a left on University, and it's right there. And if you get there ahead of me, because you might, because I got to pack up books and things, say you're with a Miracles group, and you'll be shown to a place, a big round table to sit at. Shall we share this together? We read it out loud together. We pause at every comma and take a breath at every period. Forgive us our illusions, Father, and help us to accept our true relationship with you, in which there are no illusions and where none can ever enter. Our holiness is yours. What can there be in us that needs forgiveness when yours is perfect? The sleep of forgetfulness is only the unwillingness to remember your forgiveness and your love. Let us not wander into temptation, for the temptation of the Son of God is not your will. And let us receive only what you have given, and accept but this into the mind, which you created and which you love. Amen. Thank you for being here. We will see you in a month.
Don't know how to pan.